Good morning, everybody. I must admit that I'm quite surprised that we are so many. It's still 10 o'clock in the morning, Saturday.
Welcome. So this talk is about scientific computing with Python. I would like to give you a short introduction to Python's scientific stack. Before we start, a few words about me. Okay, I'm Klaus. I do statistical modeling, or simply modeling, with Python at the Austrian Institute of Technology. Also do a lot of data analysis and visualization, and we implement numerical algorithms for a variety of different purposes. I started to do this with Python about 3 years ago, and I would have been glad if somebody had told me that it's so nice. So I'm here to do this for you. But before we go into details, maybe you can tell me something about you. Who is actually using Python? Can you raise your hand if this is the case? Okay, yeah. Python conference. And who is using Python for web development? Okay, not so many. Or system administration? Okay, and data analysis and scientific computing? Oh yeah, a lot of professionals here. Okay, so this talk will be primarily aimed at newcomers. So if you do this already for a few months or years, then there won't be too many news for you. But yeah, it's still an overview, and let's see what we have. So there is this scientific computing stack in Python, or short SciPy, or scientific Python. And first we'll see why you may even consider it to answer some questions that you might have. Then we'll go a bit into detail what it actually is, so this SciPy stack, this ecosystem for scientific computing, because this is something that I found quite confusing at the beginning. Then we'll answer the question how you can easily get started, because you need a lot of packages. This might be tedious to get them running. Then we'll take a short look at companies who are actually using SciPy to solve or address their questions. And then we have two examples that we will show you, where you can see, let's say, SciPy in action. And yeah, then we have, hopefully, the time for your questions. Okay. So, first of all, why should you even use it? Of course, I mean, it's written in Python, so for those who like Python, that's a big issue. But apart from that, it's open source and cross-platform. So, especially in research, that's a very strong point, because you can easily collaborate with colleagues, you can share your analysis. There is no problem with licenses, and you even save license costs. And yeah, it's also cross-platform, so maybe developers prefer to work under Linux. Those who use the code may work under Windows, but that's not a problem when you use this ecosystem. But apart from that, I think a very strong argument is the library system that's now available. So it's very mature and extensive. So for a lot of applications, there are very well tested and very well developed libraries that really help you to get your work done faster and more efficient, and then address the more interesting questions. And since we have an interpreted language, you can do rapid prototyping. So this is a point that is very interesting for me, for example. We have a new research project, you get some data, and then you want to know quickly what is actually in there. So you can write some scripts, explore the data, you quickly get an understanding what actually is there that you can investigate. But as soon as you know what your data or your project is about, you may need to do some software development. And this is also something that is very valuable. Possible. For example, I don't know, does anybody know MATLAB? MATLAB? Okay. And R? Yeah. Okay. So, for me, I like both MATLAB and R, but when it comes to more serious software development, I prefer to do with Python. Because you have all these nice tools and conventions that really help you set up a project and do more or less professional software development run on different platforms, different versions. You have a lot of conventions that really help you work together. And a colleague of mine, when I asked him, why are we actually using Python and not something else? And his answer was, okay, it's just the right tool for the job. So it can be even that simple. And therefore, for me at least, it's a possible alternative to MATLAB. Okay, MATLAB is not open source, R would be open source, but the programming experience is just a bit different, I would say. So this SciPy, or what is it actually?
Well, we have SciPy, and as the SciPy homepage says, it's a Python-based.
A library, so this was something that confused me at the beginning.
Scientific Python,
it's a list of packages, but it's also a certain package, as we'll see shortly. So to begin with, the very fundamental package is NumPy, numerical Python. The point is that NumPy provides a very powerful, a very basic data type, the ND array, and this is, let's say, the core building block. Everything, or almost everything, is built onto this NumPy array and the functions that operate onto these arrays. So the important thing to know is that as Python is an interpreted language, it often lacks performance. And when you want to do data analysis or when you want to solve a complicated physical model, you have to do a lot of computations. And if you have to implement this in a variety of for loops in Python, it will be awfully slow. But when you are able to express your algorithm in NumPy data structures and with functions that operate onto these NumPy arrays, then you get close to C speed, and then you have both. So you have almost the performance of a compiled language, but still the feeling, the handling of Python. And it's also important to know that internally, A lot of functions are not re-implemented in Python, but instead, they are, a lot of functionalities are just wrapped around established industry standard Fortran and C implementation. So it is quite likely that the function that you find in MATLAB is really very, very the same in Python, because in the background, they use a Fortran library, which is or a C library. So internally they both use Blaz and Layback, if you know them. So you get pretty much the same, but a different wrapper. So this is, let's say, the fundamental building block. And then we have SciPy, and this might be confusing because now SciPy is a library, and then we have Matplotlib. So in NumPy we have very basic data types, functions for random number generations, linear algebra, and maybe some FFT stuff. When it comes to more specific questions, let's say like we want to integrate a function, we want to optimize, we want to interpolate or something like this, then you have to look at SciPy. So in NumPy you have the data structure, and in SciPy you have the functions that you use to solve a specific problem. And of course it's nice to work and only look at plain numbers, but it might be even nicer to produce a plot. And this is where Matplotlib comes in. It's a very extensive package, also very mature. It's primarily for 2D plots, but base 3D plots are also possible. And with these three packages, you're already quite well on the way. But then there are three others, and together these six form the core system for scientific Python. So the one that is on the lower left here is Pandas. We will take a quick look at Pandas and at SciPy later on. Pandas is for doing data analysis. It's for flat data sets. It's a very interesting library, so when you want to do data analysis, this is the place to start. Personally, I must say that every project that I have uses at some place Pandas, because it offers very convenient data structures and tools, very powerful tools to do data analysis, because at the beginning when you get some data, you really spend most of the time to getting it into the proper form, to reshape it, to fill missing values, to transform it. It's really tedious, and Pandas is really, really good at it. So you have I/O tools, you have a lot of functionality to bring the data into the form that you can actually extract some information out of it. And then you have powerful group by and apply capabilities. So you will see later, you can group by the data easily by an age group and then aggregate and compute means for each group and stuff like this. If you're more into symbolic computing or are looking for a computer algebra system, then SymPy might be of interest to you. And last but not least, we have IPython. So IPython stands for Interactive Python, which is basically some kind of enhanced shell where you have, like in Mathematica, an input and an output cell. And it also adds additional functionality. We'll actually use it. I've seen that yesterday there was a talk about Jupyter. Does anybody know Jupyter here? Okay, some perfect. Very well, very convenient for me. We have this IPython project where you have input-output cells, and then you can render them in the browser, and that was formerly known as IPython Notebook. This is something that I will use later on, and the language-agnostic parts were sourced out. Now it's called Jupyter, but internally when you do Python, it uses IPython. So that's, but you will see later on. So these are the core packages. And of course you may say, but I want to do some image analysis or maybe more statistics. And this is where scikit come in. So you have scipy. And when it's still scientific, but maybe very, very, very tailored to a specific application, you might say you need a scikit. And there are also other packages. I cannot list all of them, but these are the ones that I think are of interest. So first of all, there's stats models, which is basically the statistics package for Python. It's not as powerful as R, of course, but for most applications it's pretty good, I think. Then you have scikit-learn, one of my favorite packages. So when you are into machine learning, this is really something that you should look at. If you want to do some image processing, it's scikit-image. And it's not a scikit, but it's also a very interesting project in my opinion. It's the natural language toolkit. So if you want to do some natural language processing like speech tagging or whatever, this is also very interesting in my opinion. And of course, yeah, I don't know. I mean, there is BioPython, there is AstroPython. So for a lot of domains, there are even research groups setting up their own Python projects for addressing the tasks that they deal with in their daily business. So there's really a really lot of activity going on here. And all of these packages rely on these packages. Maybe not all of them, I mean not all of these packages, but NumPy you find always, and SciPy, and depending, for example, stats models, Pandas is a dependency of stats models. So like in to get a bit of a feeling of R. So, okay, this is what we have. And that's an important question. So we have libraries that internally use C or Fortran, and on Windows, this is usually a pain to get these things running. So if you are not already using it, and if it does not already work, then I suggest to use a scientific distribution. Personally, I use Anaconda. It's a cross-platform, open source package management system. It ships with, I think, 180 packages. So there's pretty much everything that you need at the beginning. And it also has a package management system. There even Python itself is a package, so switching between Python 2 and Python 3 is not a problem. On Windows, I think WinPython is an interesting option. You don't even have to install it. It's nice, a nice project if you want to take a look at it. So the point is that you need It's not like in MATLAB at the university where you have a MATLAB license and all toolboxes and everything magically works. So you have to manually install the different packages, and this is often a bit tedious, and therefore when you download the distribution, everything works and everything is there. And that's for me the reason why it's a good idea to go for one of these distributions. They all ship with IPython and also Spider. Spider is a, it's called Scientific Python Development Environment. So it's quite nice. It's like MATLAB or RStudio. So you have an editor, you have an interpreter, you have Variable Explorer, project tree. You can take a look at the figures that you create. It also has PyLint support and McCabe. So it's quite nice. And with one of these distributions, there are others as well. The nice thing is that it just works. Download it, and as WinPython put it, you can run Python Spider with SciPy and friends out of the box. So this is, I think, a good summary why you may use it. But you can always install everything by hand if you prefer, of course. So yeah, well, we've now seen that there are a lot of packages. Maybe I was a bit fast, but please don't hesitate to ask if something was unclear. But the question remains, who else uses this? Of course, I think it already looked like a lot of work to set this up, but still it's unclear whether it's just a niche product and I like to promote it, or if somebody else is actually interested in this. And therefore I compiled a short overview of companies. I think you know Google. Okay. So I put Google here because they have recently released TensorFlow, which is a deep learning framework they are developing in C++ and Python. It has a nice Python API. And for me, I mean, yeah, you know that Google is using Python, but this is a very powerful library. And they really want to promote it, and they have also set up specific interfaces that look like scikit-learn, for example, so it's easy to get started. So I think that's an interesting message. CERN is using Python for data analysis. DLR, this is the German Aerospace Center, they even release Python packages. This is Aurea, they are contributing, and it's a French research institution. They are also contributing to scikit-learn. Then here you have a capital management company. They are using Pandas, for example. Pandas originated from the finance industry, and now it's open source. So these are very serious companies, I think. Spotify is also using scikit-learn, for example, to classify songs. Yeah, and the like. I mean, this could also be an even longer list, but still, I think it does not harm to give it a try, and you're in good company. Let's put it that way. So, okay, this was a very fast-paced introduction. Do you have any questions so far? I mean, I know we have the question session at the end, but okay. So, to give you a bit more of a feeling how it really looks like. Using SciPy, I've compiled two questions. The one is a small differential system, a small system of differential equations, a Lotka-Volterra equation, it's called. It's a predator-prey model. We will come to it shortly. We will use NumPy, we will use SciPy, and we will use matplotlib for some basic visualization. And the second example is that we have a small data set, wage data from the US. We look at the relationship how wage depends on age and educational level. And for this, we will use Pandas and Seaborn. Seaborn is a plotting library that uses Pandas. And you will see that with just a few lines of code, you can also already get some impression what information is contained in your data set. And for example, for me, this is really important. You get so much data, and then the question, oh, okay, what is in there? And just produce a few figures, you get some feeling, and then you know whether it's worth investing time or not. And in both cases, we use this IPython or Jupyter notebook. So I will now take a seat, and we'll see what we can do here. Oops. Maybe I won't take a seat. No, I keep standing. The cable is too short. Okay. So this differential equation I was talking about, this Lotka-Volterra equation, does anybody know it? By chance? Okay, any biologists here, maybe? Ah, okay. Okay, there's no need to be afraid of. We take a deep breath and let's take a look at it. So we are in, let's say, biology, or in a very simple form of biology. We have a system of two populations. So we have predators, you can think of foxes, and prey, rabbits. And the question that you ask is that as the rabbits replicate, or reproduce, sorry, I mean the foxes will be happy eating them, and the more rabbits there are, the foxes reproduce, and of course the rabbits run the risk of dying out. But as the population of rabbits declines, the population of foxes will also decline, and when there are no foxes left, the rabbits can reproduce again, and this is what is basically the message of this small system of equations. And what you see here is that x is the number of rabbits, let's say, y is the number of foxes, and this dx dt, so it depends on time, and this is the rate of change. So the rate of change in the number of rabbits depends on the number of rabbits, because they reproduce. So this is the reproduction term. And then we have here an interaction term. And the rate of change is negatively influenced by the number of foxes. So if there are a lot of foxes, so if y is large, then the number of rabbits decreases, because they get eaten by the foxes. So it's, I mean, it's a very simple model, but I think it's kind of reasonable. But I mean, the experts here in the audience might have their own opinion on it. So, and here in the second equation is the rate of change in the population of foxes, which is negatively depending on their own number. So if there, here we assume that if there are no rabbits left, they will simply die out. But if there are rabbits, so this x is positive, then they will reproduce. So they will eat the rabbits away. So we don't have to remember all this. We just copy it. I have here some imports, so I don't have to I don't forget them. It's nothing special here. This is something related to IPython and some imports, and here we have a list of coefficients. Also, that I don't forget it. We just execute these two lines. And now we have here the equations, and a nice thing, it should render. Usually it renders directly as LaTeX. Should look like this. Fortunately, I can cheat here. So this is how it looks like. So a nice thing in this IPython notebook is that you have code cells, and you have also markdown cells. And markdown cells natively support LaTeX. And that's it. So we don't have to remember the equation. So what we have here is this system. We will need some solver to solve this system. Fortunately, there is one. It's in SciPy. So SciPy integrate provides us with an ODE solver, and let's see what is there, so we know how we have to implement this equation to solve it. So when we take a look at the doc string, ODE int requires us to provide a function. This function is the right-hand side of the differential equation. So here we have the derivatives, and on the right-hand side we have a function. Okay, this function depends on time. Yes, I mean, it's a time-dependent equation, that's good. And we have to supply initial values. We have to supply an array, which is a sequence of timestamps for which we want to produce a result. And we can pass additional arguments directly into this function. So this is basically all that we need to solve this system. So I will not try to implement this while we are talking, but please be gentle. So we need a function for the left-hand side of this equation. And we will try to be very, very explicit about what we do. So let's say capital X is the vector that has a small x and a small y. So the capital X summarizes the population, and we have to implement this function. This function depends, of course, on x, so the population vector. It depends on t, not explicitly, but you may need it. And then we have some coefficients. And the coefficients are alpha, beta, gamma, and alpha, beta, delta, and gamma. And they are contained in this coefficients tuple. Then we want the first element of capital X to be x, and the second element to be y. And then we can basically directly write down what we have here. So dx dy equals alpha times x minus beta times x times y. And then we have dy dt. And what is this? This is delta times x times y minus gamma y. And what we return is an array. So this is now this NumPy nd array that was I was talking before. And, well, the first element is dx dt, and the second element is dy dt. So this is the left-hand side, or no, this is the right-hand side of the equation. And what we now need, initial conditions. So we have to specify at time zero how many foxes and rabbits there are. So we have x zero and y zero. So this is what we have at the very beginning. I decided that we start with 10 rabbits and 2 foxes. Hopefully that's enough, but we will see. Okay. So then what else? We need time, because we have to specify from 0 to, let's say, 15. We will see what we have. So from 0 to 15. 15 is some imaginary time interval. And we have 200 intermediate steps. And for each step, we want a solution of this equation. And yeah, then this capital X is ODE int, which is the solver that we need. And we have to supply the solver with the function. So the right-hand side of our equation, we have to supply initial conditions. We have to supply time. So for each time step, we want it to be solved. And then we can pass additional arguments. And this should be the tuple of our coefficients. And this tuple of coefficients I have already defined, because I cannot remember these numbers. It's just a tuple. Okay? And this is what we have here. And let's see. Okay, no error. That's good. yeah, and then what do we have? We have t, we have x, and then we have y. And x is not defined because x and y is transpose. So that's it. Yeah. No? Okay. The earth
I can already hear that that's not enough for you. Okay. Yeah, but this is how matplotlibs now comes into play. So we create a figure. You have a figure, and every figure has some axis, and onto this axis you draw what you want to supply. So we plot against t, because t is time, and we want to see the population of rabbits. So x, therefore we supply a label. These are rabbits. And we also supply color. I think green rabbits are okay. Then we have, of course, the foxes. Label foxes. And blue foxes, okay? Of course, we also want to supply a legend that we know what this is about. And here we are. So what we see here, that at the beginning we start with two foxes, and at the beginning we start with two rabbits. Since there are only two foxes, the rabbits happily reproduce. But, and that's the point, as the population grows, the foxes notice them, go out to hunt them, and they start to reproduce. And as the population of foxes grows, the population of rabbits declines. And yeah, this is some kind of periodic behavior. And we can now try to change the coefficients to see. Let me check the time. Okay, we have some minutes left. We can change the coefficients and see how this system then evolves. And changing coefficients should be easy. So let's first define a function. Put this into function. Solve fox rabbit, the fox rabbit problem. Rabbit asset. And there is a typo here. So we want to solve fox rabbit, and we want to supply directly the arguments. So we have a function where we can then tune the coefficients to see how everything looks like. So we decided that we start with 10 rabbits. We can even try to start with 1.5 fox. Okay. Then we have alpha. Let's put it to 1. We have beta. Let's put it to 0.1 in my notes. Then we have delta. A reasonable number seems to be 0.07. Okay, and then we have gamma. which is also a very important coefficient, which we set to 1.5. And then we need to indent this. And then we need to execute and see whether it still works. Invalid syntax. So, semicolon. Yeah, right, of course. Yeah. Okay, so still works. And now we can do some really nice thing, because this is IPython or Jupyter. Give me a second. I will now do the following. We define some kind of widget. Syntax is just something. You supply a function, solve fox rabbit, and then you can specify a range of values. So this would be nice, because when you have a range of values, we can then shift the values and see what happens. And we say that the number of rabbits should be between 0.1 and 20. The number of foxes, so it's the initial value, so I should put 0 in here. Note that these are actually the arguments in our function here. So this should be a 0. These are the arguments, and we need this line to be in here that we can really change. coefficients. So for this, we supply a range of, what's in my notes here? A range of 0.1, and then I copy the rest out of my cheat sheet. So, because I don't want to get you bored. So what do we have? We have interactive, which is some magic function. We supply interactive with a function, and then with the arguments that are passed into this function. And do you know what happens now? So this is what happens. It automatically creates sliders based on the values that you supplied here. And we can then adjust, for example, the initial number of rabbits and see what happens. Here, the scale is automatically adjusted, so we fix this. So we say that ax.z y limit, the y limit should always be between 0 and, let's say, 70. So we can more easily compare what's going on here. And then, yeah, you can adjust. Alpha was the reproduction rate of the rabbits. So you see that for small alpha, they reproduce slower, and for large alpha, the curve gets steeper. And now you can play around and investigate. Delta was the kind of the reproduction rate for foxes, depending on how many rabbits there are. So when delta is very small, you don't see a lot. I mean, the rabbits are not anymore very much influenced by the foxes. As delta gets larger, you see that the foxes become very hungry and they eat all the rabbits. Okay, so this is a very nice way to play around. Only 1 minute left. That's right. Okay. Therefore, we go again to our cheat sheet, because this wage data set, I just want to give you a very short overview. We again need some imports. Don't mind them. And then I have a CSV file. A CSV file that gives you wage data depending on age, educational level, and so on, sex, and et cetera, et cetera. And now we want to investigate what we have here. And first, we need to read it. Then you want a quick overview. So what kind of data is actually there? You ask, and this is now a pandas data frame, and a data frame knows a lot about itself. A data frame can tell you, okay, we have a column year, a column age, a column sex, race, education, etc., etc. And then, since it knows a lot, you can also ask the data frame to describe itself. For example, when you want to know in which range is actually this age variable, you can tell him, describe yourself. And then you know the youngest participant in the study was 18 years old. The oldest was 80 years old. So you quickly get an overview. But as we have seen before, plots are a better way to express information, and you can directly plot the data that is contained in a data frame. So we just set up a figure, and now we have, depending on age, the wage. So at the beginning, you tend to earn more. The rest of your life, it stays the same, and you get poorer when you as you get older. And just a few seconds, please. Now, of course, I mean, this is a cloudy thing. It's not so clear how does it really look like. So what would be nice is that if you could group by age. So every 18-year-old are a group, every 19-year-old are a group, and so on. And this is very easily accomplished, because you just say, data frame, group by. I'm interested in the variable wage. And then I want to aggregate using the median. The median is robust, and here we are. That's it. So for every age class, we aggregate it in one single line. And for me, this is really great, because otherwise I would never get finished with my work. And then there is Seaborn, I told you, a plotting framework that's building on data frames. And let's say you also want to know
how your educational level influences your income. As at universities, this is often an issue. And also we want to say, and what's about race? So I want to group it and even create subgroups, and this plotting function supplies you with this directly. So you just say, okay, on the y-axis you have wage, on the x-axis you have education, and you want to group by race. And that's it. That's it. And of course you can also print the result. Thank you. Wow.
You can still vote if there's something interesting or ask questions.
So I think the first one has been answered already. Can you show us an example of a problem you solved using Python? So, but maybe if you have any other example.
And the problem, this is my private laptop, and the examples are at work. I mean, I can tell you that a very interesting project that we had recently, which is, was quite large, is that we were predicting travel times on the Austrian motorway system. It was actually a quite huge project that we had. We did it for the Austrian Road Administration. And yeah, for this we used Python. So we collected tolling data and count data, and from this we build up a model to predict travel times on certain sections on the road. This is, for example, what we did at work. Interactive. What is meant by interactive? So you can turn it around, or But was this already the answer, or? Has everybody my Javi? It's written like this. Okay, I'm sorry. So 3D scientific data visualization and plotting. This is one of the tools I know. Maybe there are even others.
Great.
I think Bisby is something, but I'm not sure.
Good, thank you for the tip.
And there's also Plotly, if you want interactive stuff. Plotly, maybe, but not 3D. Mayavi is for 3D, yeah?
Great, thank you. So one or two more questions. Is it possible to use Python instead of LabVIEW for control lab devices?
No idea. But I know that a colleague of mine is controlling measurement devices through Python. So maybe yes, but I don't know.
All right.
Okay, I think there is a talk in the afternoon. Yeah, well then please come again here the afternoon. I think it's measurements with Python or something. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good. And the last question: of what should newcomer in SciPy beware most?
Could you specify the question? Who asked the question? Someone else. Okay, well,
I think if there are some
I mean, if you come, for example, from MATLAB, you have to get used, for example, to the indexing system, because now in Python everything starts at zero. There is a nice overview, which is something called like a NumPy for MATLAB users. So this is something that you should take a look at. And I also suggest to, at the very beginning, already take a look at some coding standards, like PEP8. It really helps you later on, because in MATLAB, everything is very uncontrolled in a sense, which might be good, but might also be bad. So this is something that I would take care of, because it really helps you evolve your skills. But apart from that, I don't know. I mean,
Klaus, thank you for the excellent presentation.